this day until tonight at 4:30. So something happened in the NFL. The Super Bowl happened, and just a quick note, who watched it or doesn't know anything about football? Who watched it? Who watched the game? So it's about 2 million in Germany watched it, and we will go through this. And it's about team composition and performance relating professional sport to business problem. That's the subject, and we got like three teams, three types of teams. So this one, they play tennis. So I play, I win or I lose, the next one comes. So they are added. They just play. It's only one team where it's a doubles, but basically if the one guy wins and the other loses, they don't really get to interchange, except for the doubles. Then we got summative teams, like a football team, where's the offense and there's the defense, and they never show up at the same time. So it's either defense or it's offense. Sometimes special teams, so that's a summative team, and there's the interactive team. Okay, so interactive means we play offense, we play defense. So at the same time, then you get subbed out, substitution, and then another guy comes in, but he will have to play offense and defense, not like handball, where you can only be like the scorer and be the good guy, or like the defender, where you only be the bad guy. So this is interactive. So one more question: who can explain just the basic rules about NFL? Can you do it?
Me?
Yeah. Yeah,
it's like the objective of one team is to do a touchdown, which is there's the end zone, and you have to bring the ball or throw the ball and catch the ball in the end zone.
Okay.
And you have an offense line and defense line, and the defense line tries to avoid the offense line to score or do a touchdown.
Mm-hmm. So basically, you have 4 tries to get 10 yards, to advance 10 yards. So you always have to get 10 yards up there. So, all right, we know what the football is, but now let's take it. This is Tom Brady in yesterday's match, Super Bowl. Like everybody watches. That's the other one. That's the main event in the United States. I don't know whether anybody's not watching. So let's take a look at the game. All right, number 24 of Atlanta goes in, touchdown 7-0. Okay? Quarterback, all right, basically a goal like in soccer, 14-0, okay? Brady, bam, interception. Okay, look at the picture right now. Look at this, remember it. All right, celebrate, that's what you have to do if you do. All right, 21-0. So, now we are 21-3, field goal, only. Okay, halftime show. Time for the coaches, much more time for the coaches to do something, to adjust. Okay? We go into the next one. Alright, and we got the biggest lead with 28-3. And the biggest lead is, so what we have here, 7-0, that's all the plays. 14-0, 21-0. Then we got 21-3, that's basically written down what happened, 21-28-3. And now this is something what we will discuss later. Those are the remaining plays which will become legendary. Alright. 28-3. Another touchdown. Alright. Then another field goal. The largest deficit in NFL history was 10 points down and winning the Super Bowl. We had 25 there. All right, another touchdown and a 2-point conversion. There you see it. 2-point conversion, meaning they will basically score another touchdown but only get 2 points. All right, and then there's this. That's a really good catch. Not on the ground, caught first down. We keep going. All right, another touchdown and another 2-point conversion, and now we go here and we got it, and we win. New England wins after being down 25 points She said München goes crazy. Tom Brady is the best football player of all time. And Bill Belichick is still the mastermind of football. And so what does this have to do with basketball? Basically a lot, because it's both American sports. And we see that there is no need to panic. So if you look at at Brady, and we saw him like this, he goes like this, goes down. Everybody said, okay, he's disappointed, 100% disappointed. But he's not disappointed. He won 4 Super Bowls, and he's not down. He's thinking. He's thinking about possessions. We will come to this later. No need to panic. We see here figure 1. This is from NBA games. So if you're down 15 points, then players think, okay, 15 points, let's say 5 minutes to go. Basketball game in the NBA is 48 minutes. In Germany, it's 40 minutes. And then the players say, okay, I have to do something. We have to score now. Score now. And what they do is they take higher risk. They shoot 3 points. Instead of going, grinding it up, trying to score 2 points, easier 2 points. No, they shoot and try to find the panic solution. And we see this in the first chart, and it's much more lucrative to just play the game, keep playing, don't panic, play the game and try to win at your game. And then we see in the last chart, always if the team is behind, they want, if it goes down, for example, to 6 minutes, 6 to 3 minutes, they shoot and shoot and shoot. 3 minutes, they still shoot. Everybody wants to shoot and wants to score 3 points instead of the maybe better 2 points. So if you take a look at the stats, then you have to say, like an unguarded shot, NBA 3-pointer is 1.07 points per possession. So if you shoot 3 times, you get about 3 points. 3 points to 1. Okay? So if you drive to the basket, meaning I go and try to have like the closest distance to the goal and try to convert, it's 1.22 points per possession, which is pretty much more than 1.07. Alright, we have this. So then we go here. No need to panic. This is the remaining place, and this is fun because when we were up there, like before the chart, this is the last. The remaining 9 plays. So I was yesterday up, like I said, 3 in the morning, 4 in the morning, with my boys. So they say the game is over. The game is over, and they left at the upper hand, like on the right. Okay, they left right here before this touchdown. I told them, why don't you wait? I mean, it doesn't really make a difference whether you go to bed. 3:30 or 4. I mean, let's watch the game. Let's have some fun. No, they said that we wanted to go. And the first, one friend said, they have to shoot like Hail Marys. There must be a Hail Mary. Hail Mary means like you basically throw the ball about 50 yards and hope, really hope, that somebody is getting it and that you score a quick touchdown. But we see here, there's no like 40 yards. It's grinding it out. One time at the next, like always going small steps, small steps, small steps. Okay? That's like the 2 points. 2 points instead of shooting all the time. 3 points. Alright, touchdown. Then, if we take a look at the total possessions, and you see that an average football game, you got.
Just a quick question.
So then, we keep going. Small steps, you get a stop. Then another small step, you get 3 points. We are right here. Kick it in. Alright, then there was interception and fumble. Another touchdown. And if you just take a look at it, you have, on average, you got 12 possessions. This is like one of those bars, that's one possession. Alright, you got 12 possessions of this on average in a game. So if you say, alright, they are down by 25 points and they still have to go a long way, but they still have those, you see it on blue, blue string, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. They got 4 drives, okay? On 4 drives you could make a maximum of 32 points, you're down 25, it's possible. You just have to score and stop, score and stop. That's basically the game. So, a And if he sees Brandon, he thinks about this. He doesn't think, oh, shit, I just blew an interception. No. He thinks about, what can I do to stay in this game and to punish the defense? What, how can I attack the defense? And that's how he looks. And it's not, he's not disappointed. He's examining his options. And he's staying calm, no need to bend. So, and they keep going, and then that's the final one. They win it, and it's, if we were in the United States, then everybody would talk about it. Alright, in the world, everybody's talking about it, if it's in terms of sports. Alright, but we want to talk about basketball, and we want to talk about business. So in basketball, there are different kinds of players. Basically, there are three types of players. We got Carmelo Anthony, who's a scorer. You give him the ball, and he will score on a consistent basis. There's, for example, Ricky Rubio. He will help you score. He's a spillover player. Alright? Spillover player is, he helps you to score by throwing good assists. And there's a defender like Dwight Howard, who is basically 7 foot, 2 meters 15, and got like a wingspan. And that's not even the highest point he can get. He can get basically up there at the very high mark. And we see it now. Third thing, Carmelo Anthony. Alright, we see he's pretty much athletic. He can move off the ball. Now he gets the ball, he will score on him pretty easily on the post. It's a touch shot, but it's not a touch shot for him. And he can shoot it from the parking lot. Boom. Alright, that's what you get with Carmelo. With the Rubio, you will get this. Passing. The legend, Kevin Garnett. Fancy passes. Eight shots, but 8 assists. Assist is like a pass to the basket. Now he's driving, he can drive, but he's not that good at scoring himself. Alright, makes it look easy. Let's go. Alright, next player, number 12. He also makes it look easy, but not for the offensive player. So we all see that this guy can jump and he can on-ball defense and off-ball defense. So this is not that good idea to drive to the basket against him. So what we see, he's a beast, alright? He knows how to defend. And I think it's pretty clear that he's a defensive player. So then we look at this, because everything is about money, right? In the NBA, for sure, because you have a salary cap. Let's say you can spend $99 million, and you can split it up between the players. Basically, if you got Kobe Bryant or LeBron James, you give him $30 million, because he's the best player on the team, or in the NBA. And so, they made this study and looked, what's up with, okay, we got those three types of players, and what can we, like, how are they developing in their salary increase? So if they increase by 1 standard deviation, and you're a scorer, yeah, scoring is pretty easy in terms of recognizing it. Alright, you get the ball, put the ball into the basket, everybody says alright, put the ball into the basket, it's a good thing. So, alright, maybe somebody set him up. Not everybody does see it. Alright, you got a score, and if he scores, like one standard deviation up, he gets a 41% salary increase. So everybody wants to score, of course. And if you got a defender, it's a 15% salary increase. Alright? Dwight Howard, he's the defender, he will give you something. He's not going to give you that much on offense, although he believes that he will give you very much. But he's a defender, he should just accept it. Let's see whether this happens in history. I don't think so. So, and then we got a spillover player. Well, there's no increase at all. So if I'm the main guy, but I'm like a good guy, yeah, I want to have a score. I want to make you look good. I want to give you an open shot. I want to give you a layup. Then that's pretty. I mean, I help other players, but really, do I get anything out of it? No, I don't get. Like, I don't get an increase. And like, what Schwib already told us is, what happens if you trade away the scorer? Let's say if you trade away Carmelo Anthony and you got a great passer or a spillover player instead, what really does happen? and they made this measurement, and it said this would give the team a net increase of about 5.3 points per game relative to their opponent. And if you think about it, that basically 25, 26, 27% of our games fall within 5 points. And you get 5 points by trading the way you score, but get a spillover player, then you have to say, like, why is not everybody doing this? The easiest question is, it's not always about success in terms of wins. It's about marketing. It's about marketing, for example, a Russell Westbrook. It's about marketing a James Harden. Although they are great players, and this season they really go up top. But if you just take a look at it, you always want to have a star because you want to sell tickets. You want to sell their jerseys. That's what it's about. That's what it's about in the NBA and in the professional world. And here we see, as I said, what a difference a LeBron makes. So if we take a look at J.R. Smith, Kevin Love, and Channing Frye, they shoot 3 points, 34.7%. But if LeBron James, only if LeBron James passes them the ball, if he plays them open, then he shoots 38%. So, increase. Kevin Love, he shoots 43.3% if LeBron passes him the ball. Because he's so good and attracts so much attention of the defense that he will pass, and he's a scorer, a defender, and a spillover player. And he's the best player of the NBA. He's the face of the NBA since about 7 years. All right? And he went, don't get me wrong, I think he went to the finals 7 times in a row. Right now. So basically, pretty good player. Channing Frye. 59% shooting when LeBron passes, 35.3 when another guy passes. So it actually makes a difference if you're a spillover. So now we take a look at the San Antonio Spurs. Pass, 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 move, cut, another cut, and you get an easy dunk. Alright, the San Antonio Spurs. They are the team in terms of the last 21 years. If you take a look, their playing style is totally different from, for example, Lakers, Miami Heat, or also Golden State Warriors, although they came together. And we got Greg Popovich, and I really took the nice picture of him. You will only see him grumbling and yelling, not yelling all the time, but he will never be satisfied. But he's like, he's a great leader, and he gets everybody into the boat. If that even is in English. All right, winning percentage over 21 season, 69.4%. That's the third best in the NBA history after Steve Kerr, who's with the Golden State Warriors, who won it 2 years ago, but he's only 3 years in, and a guy named Phil Jackson, who coached Shaquille O'Neal, Kobe Bryant, and of course Michael Jordan. So everybody should know Michael Jordan, I hope so. He had great quality of players, and he made them into, let's say, somewhat of a team to have. But this is not Phil Jackson, this is Greg Popovich, and everything about their offense is about being spillover players. They say the quality of their decision making is evident. We pass up a good shot for a great shot. Basically, what they say, if we have a shot where we get, everything is measured in possessions in basketball, we get a shot where we have 1.01, let's say for a guarded three-pointer, like if you shoot from the arc behind the arc, you get 3 points. But if there's a defender, on average you get 1.01 points per possession. So let's say you got a great shooter, like Kawhi Leonard. He takes the shot, he could take the shot, but he says, alright, I'm gonna pass it up to you, because you're much more open than I am, and this will give us 1.07 points per possession. And if you calculate it up, then you just say that really makes sense. But it only makes sense if everybody's doing it. For example, I get a pass. I get to shoot. I could shoot, or could pass, make the extra pass, but I'm not shooting. Because I say, alright, I want to be a scorer. I said 41% increase salary. I need money, really, like NBA players. Minimum mortgage is 1 million, average is 5 million, I need that money, I need to pay the house, right? Then we say, I didn't have it. So, and then the next guy who was open, what will he say? I mean, I have to think of me. I have to think of my family and my house. I have to take the shot. And then you never get a great shot because you only will have something like a good shot. Alright? So, what they do is they maximize possible defensive mistakes by moving the ball, many touches, and quick decisions. So they give the defense a chance to make a mistake, basically. And they have many spillover players, and they are, on average, the oldest team. So, why are they the oldest team? Because they say, we want players who are over themselves. They want players to say, I don't need to have the money right now. I don't need to be the main scorer. I've shown what I can do. For example, if I've shown that I can make 15 points on average, that's what my capability is. But I like to win a championship because it's much more fun. That's what it's all about for competitors. If you're only egoistic and if you only want to have money, then it's not going to matter. So, players who are older themselves, basically old, shared experience and passing on the torch, will be talked later. But before we go there, I'd like to have one more thing and try to convert. Now, I've talked a lot about football, all right, basketball. I think it's very interesting, obviously. But let's take a look at how business are run. Like, can somebody give an example of a score, a spillover player, and a defender? What does this make? What's the impact of this in business? Just go on. So we got a score. Who could be the score? What is he work? Let's say he works at IT. Who would be then the spillover player?
Maybe his assistant. Yeah.
Okay, basically he helps. And who would be like the defender? Somebody got to write the bills, for example? Could be, for example, defenders could be controlling. Like, spillover guy could be the guy in between those who actually make something happen, somebody who invents something, or somebody who saves something, and the spillover guy is somebody who will help the score to get there. So that could be something we could translate to business. I hope this was somewhat clear. Okay, and then we go back, share experience. So in every team, if you want to be successful, in most cases, you have to have some kind of shared experience, some kind of continuity. And it's great with the San Antonio Spurs, because they have like this saying where they say passing on the torch. So passing on the torch means we got David Robinson, 1999, great player, with Tim Duncan. Okay? Then Tim Duncan takes over the team. With Manu Ginobili, also great players. Then it's Tony Parker who takes over, but they still have like the same core. And it's very important to have not the same players all the time, but to have some kind of core for a team to develop, because it's easier, and we will come to this later, to get into certain kind of roles. Alright, and then we got obviously Kevin Leonard, who will take over the team in this next years. What they say is great teams touch each other. And they measure it. So they say winning teams touch each other by going like this. Don't let me hang. Fist bump! Alright. By going shoulder to shoulder. By going high five. By pointing at you. Good job. They do this. That's what winning teams do. And I'd like to add one thing. Pointing guards, clapping guards, are winning guards, although they might be in a deficit. You players, it's easy to separate. If you're down 28-3, it's easy to say, man, you didn't do your job. You didn't do your job. Get the job done. Everybody shouts. Get your shit together. So, and what happens here? You're not gonna get the shit together. Because it takes the whole team to get something together. So, and then if you go back to Brady, if you look at Brady, how he talks to his guys, he will never be like at this distance. He will always come close to you and tell you something. Stand like this next to you. Tim Duncan, he will grab you and say, man, it was the worst shot ever. But he will take you and say, the next shot will be good. So, great teams touch each other and they don't go into a distance. They try to be close. And you can see this. In basketball, there are situations where there's a foul, right? Free throws or something coming up. So the game starts. And then you take a look at the guys huddle up, that's what they call. They get together and talk to you. So to say about the next play, what the next strategy, what are we going to do now? So if you say losing teams, they are like this, alright? The distance is pretty wide. And assistant coaches, they check this. And if they are like this, like next together, very close, it's pretty likely that they are up or that they got a great call. Because they get together much closer. And that's the difference. It's really a difference between winning and losing teams. And now we got the numbers. Okay. Now we're going to the stages of a team development. If we, let's say, Tigers, all right? World Tigers Tübingen. I hope somebody knows. If you're a club in this league, then basically every year you have to tame your roster new. Because let's face it, you have a player who plays great. You cannot afford him. He will go. Alright? He will have the 3 times as much money as you can pay him. So then you have players who didn't play that well. You don't want them back, for sure. Because if you know he's not good, why would I take him? The only thing would be if I say, okay, he's very talented, maybe we can sign him for a 2-year deal and say we keep him in the team. That would be a way of continuity. But either a guy is good or he's the bad, and then you basically have to set up a team every season new. Alright? And then you have the stages of team development. And then you go from the very beginning. You get to know each other. I'm Jens. You're Will. I'm, and so on. So everybody says, all right, that's who I am. Nobody knows anything about the other. And in a heated atmosphere, when they're like, for example, in Denver, when there's 7,000 crazy guys who just want you to lose, then it's pretty tough to stay together as a team if you did not have this shared experience. And if you didn't go through some experiences. So, basically, you get to know each other. That's the first stage. And then it's confrontation. Defining roles. And sometimes, this is the last step for teams in the season. They never get to define their roles. Because it takes also somewhat of taking down my pride to accept the role. For example, if I'm a guy who basically only has to hustle and just defend. Everybody wants to score because you get applause and everything, and you get a bigger salary. And so you always have this confrontation. And you got for each position, basketball is played 5 men. We will talk about the 5 men, the lineups. And you got for each position, you got 40 minutes to give. And then I will give you 25 minutes and her 15 minutes. Will you get along with each other? Do you accept this role? Will she accept her role? It's pretty likely that you will accept the role because you've got 25 minutes and you've got the chances to score. But whether you will accept it, and if you're both at the same skill level, we will see. And there's already a conflict there. But they don't know. Consolidation. That's the third stage. And if she accepted like they not, okay, she said, alright, I will accept the role, she will accept the role, then it's fine. And if you got everybody got this accepted votes coming in, for example, with the San Antonio Spurs, come in, and then there are three guys who won multiple championships together, and they say, okay, you can go there, you can do this, you can do that, but at this point, we will do this and that. Then it's easy. You just give him this, you give this player this role. You are going to be free and shoot the ball, few of them, defend and succeed. And then you can go to performance. So, and if we look at the individual and also at team perspective, we got possible decreases of motivation. So, maybe I'm giving you too many information. So, that could be. Then I'm a bad teacher, because I hope you can get, or maybe somebody sits there, but this guy is talking, that's so easy, why does he make such a fuss about it? So, and in each of these stages, you have, you're not in the flow channel. So, let's say you got a great skill, you're a great player, and I tell you have to shoot like from 1 yard to the goal, you will say, it's easy, why do I have to do this? That's frustrating, that's wasting my time. But if I say, like for example, if I tell Shaquille O'Neal, does anybody know Shaquille O'Neal? Like 7 foot, 215, couldn't shoot, but he would dunk every time. He's the player with the most dunks. Dunk meaning he will put the ball directly into the hoop, and he's about 150 kilos. If you're kind to him, if you're realistic, it's about 160. So what we cannot tell him that he should shoot 3-pointers. We tell him, go there, bang your way to the basket, and score there. So, we always have to look at the skill. I think it's pretty much self-explanatory. Csikszentmihalyi made this, they are the same type of player. Both players are the type of player of playing precise passes. But there's not like one player who will be the guy who makes the innovative passes, the pass creativity, and the one guy who backs him up. Basically, the one guy who's the spillover player and one guy who's the scorer in some terms. So, also if you put, for example, let's say Cristiano Ronaldo and Dani Alves, two very offensive guys on the right wing, what will they do? They will try to score a goal, of course, because that's what their main strength is, offensive, their offensive potential. It's very unlikely that you will see Cristiano Ronaldo run all the way back to make a tackle. That's not going to happen. Really unlikely. So, because he says, I will score. So, which player combination is the best two-man combination? That's a question. There's no answer. But this is a question, like every coach or also every enterprise should figure out. And if you take a real look at it, everybody has to figure out by himself, who am I? Basically, the question of us, who am I and who fits the best with me? Which five-man lineups are the most effective player combinations? How will this affect the game of basketball? So I have one theory. It's a Liggins effect. Liggins plays with LeBron James, the guy who's very good, Kyrie Irving, another good guy, Kevin Love, and Tristan Thompson. And for some reason, they are the best lineup in the NBA right now. And then I took a... And if you have to know Liggins. He played, never played NBA. He played here in Europe, he played in Bremerhaven. He's not a great NBA player. I would say he's not even an NBA player. So, but he's still the guy in the best lineup. And then you have to ask yourself, why is this guy in the best lineup? And I will tell you, because he doesn't touch the ball. And he doesn't want to touch the ball. That's not his role. It's just not his role to touch the ball. You will see LeBron, like here, to the basket. There's Liggins, he's open, and he goes, I'm not going to pass it to you, because I know you can't do anything with it. And this guy, you know what? He's totally fine with it, because he says, I know how good I am. I'm not an NBA superstar. I know that I have got limited capabilities, but I'm in the best lineup right now in the world. That's great for me. And what will he do? he will not touch the ball unless he gets a rebound. Rebound meaning the ball gets from the basket and he just grabs it because he's hustling. He's going to hustle. He's pursuing the rebound. So he's giving the effort. What he will do is, for example, if he defends Steph Curry, who is an incredible shooter, and he will just be on his ass. He will follow him everywhere he goes. He will only concentrate on being the defensive guy stopping him. He doesn't want the ball, he doesn't need the ball, he only is there to defend. At one point, if you take in the supermarket at the supermarket, and the most productive guy you put in here, and then the next guy you put here, and here, and if this guy is seen by everybody else, yeah, then they will, all of them will work better. Because he's hustling and they can say, okay, this guy is hustling, I have to do something too. If you see, and that's I think the kind of principle of this, what I want to call Lincoln's effect. Let's see if we can prove this.
I just wanted to offer myself for the Tigers, and I'm fine with not touching the ball. So.
That's very nice. If you want, we can have a trial tomorrow. We're not going to give you any money, but you can come tomorrow at 8 to the Panzerhalle, and then we'll see whether it works out. All right. So, actually, it's a good point. What happens? Let's do it better.
Just a little for fun.
The most. Can you look like a professional basketball player?
Probably I'm too small, I'm only 180. I'm a bit. So
if you got any chance to grow a little more, look a little more like a basketball player, so the guys think that we cannot leave this guy so much open that you're forced to take the shots,
yeah.
Then there's a chance.
So tomorrow morning, 84.
Tomorrow? Okay, all right. How will this affect the game of basketball? This 5-minute lineup. How do we have to pick personnel on quality? So, I'm also in music, and if we take a look at how are big orchestra recruiting their personnel, and they say, all right, play. Play your violin, okay, and then I will say, okay, that's pretty good, or that's not good. Basically, in most cases, they say that's not good enough, okay, we need another guy. So, but this is really smart that you play in what will later be a register, like what will be a team, five man team, 10-man team. Is it smart that I will check your skills, or is it smart whether I check how are you with us? How do we sound with him? Maybe he's not that good, but somehow it really sounds good. Yeah? And it's always borderline in terms of great quality. If you look at Manuel Neuer, I mean the coaches of him, they must get nuts if he's all the way outside his goal and shooting the ball anywhere, and maybe just 2-3 goals per season. But if he's standing by Munich and he can do this and Guardiola wants him to do this, then he's perfected his skill. If you look at chess players, they are their tone, like if they play a C, it's much more like it's not only a C, it's sometimes it goes up and down. It could be a B, it could be a C sharp. So it's always in between, and it's not always that we have to have this, it's not mathematical music, for example, where it really is. Also, is it possible to have too much money? I said yes, marginal benefit of Premier League teams versus Bundesliga teams. I think if you got like 80 million for your team, like Borussia Dortmund, yes, it's fine, it's good enough, because if you got 120 million or even 200 million for your players, which player will be the Gattuso of this team? Which player will hustle? Which player will be the Liggins? If you are solid, you're not going to be the Liggins. You want to have, you want to be the best player. And I think that it's actually possible to have too much money and you see that the Premier League teams don't win the Champions League. All right, to finish it off, I got a little riddle for you, and I'd like to say, let's say, okay, this part, you're going to go in groups of two, please, and you're going to go in groups of five, assemble together. And this is a riddle, there's no solution really, but we will see what we can get out of this. You have to build up a one-year chess band of five players, drums, piano, bass, guitar, and a lead. This lead could be a trumpet, this lead could be a saxophone, it could even be a dancer or a singer. With a budget of 50,000 for a two-hour concert, it's not 30 minutes. 30 minutes is, you can only have solos. It's a two-hour concert, so you have to see that it does not get boring. Even if the best player is there, you have to mix it up. You must have a lead. Somebody who will sell the CDs, and you can have a second and third soloist could go along with the other band. But all players are professional. So please go together, five guys, five girls, or mix it up, of course, and split the money, and we will get back to this in 5 minutes and see what happens. There's no real solution.